Welcome to another episode of Behind the Science Rockstar Edition. I'm your host, Jennifer Fournier. Worldwide, the honeybee population has experienced a widespread collapse, a recent phenomenon known as colony collapse disorder. Many things have been hypothesized, such as a change in weather pattern, loss of their natural habitat due to building, or potentially a pest that is invading hives. In this episode of Behind the Science, we will look to test one theory and look to confirm or eliminate one potential cause to try and solve the case of the missing bees. Wow, another bee on the endangered list. I gotta go find Lauren. Lauren, just the person I was looking for.
How you doing, Jen?
Good, so you do a lot of testing on food products, right?
That's correct.
What's this buzz about the bees?
Well, the honeybee population, as you probably saw, has been suffering a massive decline around the world. And it's in part due to this phenomenon called colony collapse disorder. So this particular disorder is where the honeybees will leave their hive for no apparent reason.
What could be causing that?
Well, there's a lot of theories. One is a virus, one is possible other insects, but the main theory is the use of the pesticide imidacloprid. Let me go to my notebook and show you a little bit more about that compound.
Great.
So imidacloprid is a neonicotinoid insecticide, and it was first registered for use in the United Kingdom in 1991, and then the US in 1993. And it's used to control various insects that could affect crops, as well as wood-boring insects. It's marketed for use on more than 140 crops, including rice, sugar beets, potatoes, vegetables, citrus fruit, apples, and pears. And it's also effective against soil insects, Japanese beetle larvae, termites, and biting insects that can be used as a flea repellent for dogs.
So very interesting, Lauren. So we have the hypothesis about the pesticide, but I'm missing the connection to the bees.
Well, Jen, we have actually a very interesting, somewhat local example where the Asian longhorn beetle population, an invasive beetle species, was treated with imidacloprid. So local entomologists took an interest in monitoring how this imidacloprid application could potentially impact the honeybee population as well. So we were fortunate enough to have access to samples of bee pollen, which is a product from the bees themselves, that may have been exposed to imidacloprid. However, this is a highly complex sample. I actually have it right here.
Interesting.
So what we're going to do is we're going to try to detect very low levels of the imidacloprid pesticide in this matrix, this very, very complex matrix. And we want to look for low levels because we want to see any impact that this pesticide could have at those low levels on the honeybee population as well. So in the following work, we had to employ a cleanup step because bee pollen is a very, very complex matrix, where we have an average of about 20% protein content and 6% total lipid content, as well as a variety of vitamins, fatty acids, enzymes, and pigments. So in the following work, a specialized extraction technique where we use the Waters CEPAC C18 cartridges was used to remove these numerous matrix interferences. We then subjected this to the highly sensitive detection system, the Zevo TQS, in order to see the imidacloprid pesticide at picogram per gram levels. So table one here is going to be showing us the extraction recovery, which we had 95% extraction recovery across a 1 picogram per gram spiking level. The matrix suppression was around 62.51%. So this is a very high amount of matrix suppression where we have to combat it again with a very good detection system. The samples that we analyzed are samples taken from a local area where imidacloprid had been applied for controlling a local beetle population. So shown in figure A, what we see is the amount of imidacloprid detected in the first sample. This was a very, very low level. This was actually below our limit of quantification. In sample B, however, what we have is a quantifiable level of imidacloprid. And this is at the picogram per gram level. In figure C, what we see is a 100 picogram per gram spiking of imidacloprid in our sample as well. So again, this is highlighting the fact that although we have a very complex matrix, we're able to see these very relevant low levels of the pesticide.
Lauren, thank you for taking me through how we test for that.
Sure thing, Jen, anytime.
Now that's something I can tweet about.
There is a delicate balance in the environment, and maintaining this harmony is what experiments like this are focused on. Having analytical solutions that are highly sensitive and robust provides a powerful tool to help solve unique environmental monitoring challenges. For more details, check out the technology brief we described. And join us next time for another episode of Behind the Science Rockstar Edition.